Means.
Dan, I'm hitting the record. Can you hear the dog barking or not?
We can.
Little bit.
Yeah, but it's not too bad.
I don't know why they decided to
Ambience.
let her escape now and make a mess right as if we're going live. Like,
You
there's.
good though? Do you need to
You could go do whatever, man.
before?
I'm not in any hurry.
No, it's fine.
Okay.
Okay.
It's funny that they decided to do. I just want to get a good sample for the beginning, Dan, on the recording, so the barking is not there. Hold on. Okay, I
Do you guys
think it's
need me to? Do you guys need me to record audio anyways?
no,
Nope.
you're
Okay.
fine.
I was just making sure. That's
Yep.
all.
We're good, thanks.
Right, so I think we're good, Dan. I'm gonna hit record now.
Hail and well met, my fellow Hearthstone players, and welcome to Hearth Coach, the podcast that can help you be legendary. I'm your host, Dan, and this is my co-host, Frid.
Hello, everybody.
He is a player of legend rank, and I have convinced him to coach me and record it in podcast form and put it out there so as to hopefully help some more of you make it to legend also. All right, here we are, 154? Wow. I believe, if I'm
Yes,
not
154.
mistaken. Wow, okay. Getting close to that 3-year mark.
Yeah,
Won't be
it's
long
getting there.
now. And here we are on a special live weekend edition of Hearth Coach. I know those of you listening to the recorded version, this doesn't really mean anything to, but to everyone tuning in, hey, how's it going?
Hello, everybody.
Yes, and of course, as usual, when we do one of these live things, we usually have a guest that we will get to quickly.
He's one of those that we've helped make it to legend also. So we'll get to that shortly.
That's okay. My week, it's I'm sitting on rank 10, got a couple of stars. I think I might even be on a win streak. I'm not sure. I've done that though since this, we're recording on a Sunday. I finally started winning some games Friday night. Man, after recording the last one, it was rough trying to get off the 15th floor. I just kept bouncing around, trying different decks. I was just like, wow, I don't know. But finally, I've just been doing the aggro paladin, and it's been working.
All right.
I've been just been getting those the lucky draws once in a while, getting that silence on the Void Lord when necessary type of things, and beating those priests to the punch before they can get the machine gun out and stuff like that. So,
Yeah, you gotta do it before that because it gets too late.
Once they can start that machine gun action, it's yeah, you just yeah, anyway, you just move on after
Yeah,
that.
it's if you can't kill him on time, it's like, all right, good.
And I look and I'm like, oh, I'm almost out of cards. I can't believe this game went this long. Yeah, okay. I don't even have anything left in here to kill him with. All right, next game. So that's been that's been my week. Nothing, just been trying to keep warm. Holy heck.
Oh,
North
yes.
Florida, we've had our cold snap. Hopefully that's it for the year.
It's cold here too, but not too
I'm
bad.
done with that. If I had firewood, I'd have a fire going in the fireplace right now, but we are fireless at the moment.
Ah, but you got the studio set up. I see the banner, the whole works.
Oh yes. Everyone can't see it. Once I get things more suitable, I get a camera, maybe I can move around. I could show everybody the fireplace and stuff over there and the tremendous cat tree I built over there.
Very nice.
It's something else. It's so big, it's something the cats can grow into. Anyway, so real quick, that's been my week. The Hearthstone really last couple of days kicked in good. I've been dabbling with hitting rank 9. And maybe we'll get that done today, my friend. How's your week been?
It's fine. I started on a low note. I don't think this had happened by then, but I played my match SHL match.
Oh, I forgot about that.
And I botched the first game with a cube log against a mage. Anyway, I ended up losing 1-2-3, so that was disappointing. And I think the whole team kind of, I was the first up and probably set the tone. Everybody just kind of had a rough time, except Blake. He won his match. He squeezed by very early, so we just need to focus and kind of get it together for the second week. Just put this one behind us, because I know you also had a rough time.
So. Yes. yeah, real quick, my THL week, I also went 1-3. My first match, I blew him out of the water with the Secret Mage, crushed the Warlock. Then I came up against a big, easy Druid, and man, he just high-rolled me. I had just struggled trying to get I played tempo decks. I struggled just even trying to get anything going. All the right cards on curve up to the Death Knight on, what's their Death Knight cost? Like 8 or something. So that came out on curve game.
It cost 7. Malfurion.
7. Yeah. So it was, he had that on 7 every game, which was actually not even turn 7 because of all the extra ramps. So it was usually like turn 4 or 5. Yep. He's playing that. So So anyway, that was how the rest of my matches went.
The one I played, he had the Aluneth every time on turn 6. So it was a problem. But anyway, he teched the mage against warrior, which was pirates, and he had Galaka crawlers and oozes, and he got it all like early. So anyway, it was a mess. So I may shelve that pirate warrior. The reason I played it is because it's different, and because that's how I got legend, and because he was playing pirates in mage and Galaka crawlers in mage and oozes in mage. Anyway, I don't want to talk about it anymore. So in terms of the ladder, I got to rank 6. I was just talking before the match before the recording that I was at 5 stars and I had a priest. And you know what happens when you play priest if you don't kill them. Or try to play around, like, okay, is it Dragonfire Potion, or is it Anduin, or is it Psychic Scream, or is it the Kazaku's Potion that they got, or is it the Alkanite Circle, or which one is it? And it turns to be all of them, always. Yeah. And you're like, what? How? Like, no matter what you do, even if you know. So it's kind of like Arena, in a sense. You just don't play around any of this crap. Oh, and also the Pyromancer and the 3 or 4 combo spells that cost 1. Yep. You're like, how? Okay, forget trying to think, okay, if I do this, it's better. You just play and hope that you can kill him, essentially. So, I did it in that case, but sometimes you can. If they miss one of those things, any of those things, you can get to it. But I'm hoping that thing goes away eventually, I think, once the rotation happens. But it's another 2 or 3 months, so it's going to be a while. And we'll be stuck with it. It's the most played deck. And they also have variants of priest, so it's a bit of a challenge. But yeah, that seems to be the strongest. They've refined it to the point where it's essentially everything is a draw, clear, and the combo. So you can do the Velen trick. So it's just like a miracle kind of deck again. But with all the draw and all the board clears and all that stuff. So it's pretty annoying. But I think when you think about balance, I mean, maybe a little too powerful, but when you think about balance, that's how it works, right? If I draw Kalaseth on 2 and I get all my stuff buffed up, the only way that deck can compete is by having all that other stuff, right? Because otherwise they would lose every time and they wouldn't be it. So even though it feels frustrating, I think it's somewhat balanced. I don't know. It's my opinion. But rank 6 right now, so not too bad. Not sure if this month's going to be it. We're back on the swing of like school and all kinds of stuff, but I'll give it a shot as always. But I don't want to have to keep a 24-month streak alive again anymore.
Don't worry about it. I hear you.
Yeah. So anyway, with that, let's introduce our guest who's been patient enough over there, up there in the top spot of the camera. He sent in his entry for the Hall of Legends couple months ago, So we featured him. He is also a fellow podcaster on the Tier 5 podcast, all the way from Denver, Colorado. It's Rod Johnston. How are you, man?
How's it going, guys? I'm doing pretty good myself. How about you guys?
I'm doing great. I assume Fred's doing pretty good.
We're doing good. Welcome.
Speaking for him.
Welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me, guys.
Yeah, thanks for being here, man. I enjoy your podcast. I subscribed, downloaded the last couple, and I'll be listening. It's pretty good.
So it's fun, guys. It's a good time.
So I confess, I was not a listener. I knew that it was out there because, you know, we check the rankings and we want to see, and that's when we noticed, oh, there's like more new podcasts, and that yours was one of them. But it's funny, when I was talking to Rod about coming on the show, he's like, man, I'll try to keep it clean for the show. And I was like, what kind of show do you do? Let me go listen to it.
I have a tendency to say four-letter words in an excessive fashion. Kind of telling you guys, I kind of got into it. I grew up with a father who was in the military. He was a military policeman, and he's got the our family's very Scottish, so there's a temper on top of that. And so I grew up learning to swear like a sailor, and also one of my favorite movies as a small child was Die Hard, so that just tells you everything you need to know about me and my tendency to say four-lettered words. But
it's all good.
I struggle myself. I grew up on my dad had a construction company, and I grew up on construction sites in the 80s, so getting around some pretty colorful people, felons and bikers, like real bikers.
Oh, I can only imagine.
Oh yeah, I know I can be colorful. That's easy. That part's easy. It's not saying it. It's the hard part.
Yeah, believe me, I'm very used to it. It's living in a corporate environment like I do. I have to be mostly good most of the time, so I can do it when I try. So
so all right, well, for to help our listeners who may not know you, maybe you can tell us a little bit about yourself. How did you get started in gaming, or is Hearthstone your first like real game?
No, I grew up with video games my entire life. Like, one of my earliest memories is like an Atari my parents had with like Dig Dug and what is it, like Burger Time. So some of the earlier things. And then I got into like Nintendo. Mm-hmm. I got a Nintendo for Christmas when I was about 5, and it's been video games ever since. PlayStation, Xbox, all that stuff up until like 2015, my co-host of my podcast, Adam, was like, you need to play this game, because I'd played collectible, card games, but never digital ones. And he got me going on it, and I've played, I think, every single day since then. So it was like January 1st, 2015, I started playing. So I just hit my like 3-year mark with the game. I get addicted to things. Like, over the years, I've been addicted to things like Call of Duty, and I play excessively. but Hearthstone is got its hold of me like worse than most things. So I've played other Blizzard games. I've played, you know, the Warcrafts and Diablo, and I was minorly hooked to WoW for a while. But it was Hearthstone became the crack of the gaming community to me, because it's addictive, but then it's got that thing where you can play it on the go too, which is such a big thing nowadays.
Yeah, that's what made it a thing for me when they came out with mobile versions, because otherwise it would be hard to try to get away to sit in front of a computer. But the fact that you can do it anywhere, that's crazy.
It's one of those things where I go off and on with how much I play digitally, but I mean, on my phone, but when I'm being competitive, I like to sit at a computer and play Hearthstone, but I have lots of periods where I'll just sit on the couch and sit there and play and not do anything else, just pay attention to the card game. So,
yep.
excuse me, guys. So yeah, it's one of those things where I've been addicted for a long time, and I played it casually pretty much until kind of towards the end of last year. And when the Mean Streets came out, I hit rank one for the first time, and I was like addicted to it at that point. And then over the next, 6-8 months, I got really competitive and got really, into hitting Legend. And then I started my podcast, and I was like, oh, I really got to hit Legend now. And I got obsessive with it. So I finally did it in August, when the Knights of the Frozen Throne came out. You guys did help a lot, believe me. It's the whole – what I think you guys provide, which is really, really helpful, is you guys let other people know that there are people out there,
that pushing, struggle.
Yeah, pushing us. And I think that's one of the things – I've talked about it on my own podcast, but, the whole, I think people sometimes think that getting to Legend and playing the game at a high level is hard, and is hard but not, really hard, and they don't understand how difficult it is. And when you're hard on yourself playing this game, it makes it even more difficult, right? So you guys do a really awesome job of just kind of helping people realize that the game's hard and it takes a lot to make that push. And I think you do really help lots of members of the community see that. So
yeah, you were the 32nd. We had another one come in. I think there's been two more, so we're maybe up to 34. I gotta go check that. But it's.
I think we made the podcast we wanted to hear.
Yep. Yeah, you guys do an awesome job with it. Yeah.
Yeah. The Dan's idea is crazy. Dan's crazy idea. I don't know.
So I don't know how I talked him into it, but.
So it's. Okay, go ahead.
No, I do want to hear about your origin story for your podcast, but before we do that, we do like to ask about, so you've been playing for 3 years, so you probably have a full collection, but thinking about when you started, how did you go about building it? Were you just dump cash? Did you grind it? Did you play Arena? What was the strategy?
So when I started playing, I wanted to be free to play, and so I got all the cards you get when you start playing, right? And then my co-host Adam helped me disenchant a bunch of the useless cards or higher end cards that I really wasn't going to need. I remember him going, oh, we're going to disenchant this Ragnaros. I'm like, but he's cool. But I didn't have a collection. So I did that and started playing Zulok back in the day, and then moved on into Mech Mage because that was really powerful at the time. And I got frustrated after a while because I was getting, that was when Dr. Boom was around.
Oh,
and
God.
And you're sitting there and you're like, turn seven comes out and you're like, but I don't have Dr. Boom. And I got addicted to collecting at that point. And so I dumped a bunch of cash into it in 2015.
There we go. Okay.
Yeah.
And you know what's weird is Dr. Boom wouldn't even be that great of a card right now.
Yeah. That's why people keep saying it. And it's true, because by the point turn seven is around, you're either dead or your opponent has 800 armor and it doesn't matter, right? It's the broken stuff you could do in the game now. It's like, oh, you got a 7/7 and 2/1/1s that can explode. I got quarter creepers on turn three.
Yeah.
So
oh my God. I was watching got a Ancient of Lore, I think from a Swashburglar or something, and I'm like, oh my God, that card was nerfed because it was too powerful. And now it's like, what? That doesn't do anything the way it was.
So
the way it is. I mean,
I'm participating in this league. I don't know if you guys have heard of it, called the United Hearthstone League.
I heard what you were talking about on your podcast.
Yeah, so it's eight podcasters or members of the community, and it's got a really cool format that where it's, you have to use all 9 classes over 3 weeks. So you bring 3 classes each week. So I was messing with my decks for this first week, and I start going, I have to use Warrior. and I got a buddy to sit there and tech out decks with me. And I'm like, man, Warrior's in a really not good spot right now. It's just, it's a really hard class to play and win when you're getting so aggressively swarmed down in this meta. So
Fritz says Pirate Warrior is good. That's He's had how, lots of luck with it.
That's how I made Legend. But this was Risen. He was the one that gave me the deck. He made it to Legend, and I did too. So we have two data points that prove it works. It's because there were no Galaka crawlers. They're showing up again. I've seen them. So it's not. I don't know. We'll see.
It was when this new meta started. People weren't playing Tempo Rogue at first either. Like, it was almost exclusively aggro pally, and so people start taking those cards out because there were less pirates in the meta. Yeah. And you're not running dangerous of pirates in most of these aggro pally lists, right? So it calmed down now, and people are doing that again, and it's just like, yeah, I don't think in the next couple weeks or month it's going to be all that different from the end meta of the last meta, just with more broken cards on top of it, like Cordo Creeper, right? So
yeah. Okay, so didn't mention if you played Arena much.
I have 540 wins in Arena. I'm a casual Arena player. I get into it at times, but I always feel bad playing Arena because I feel like I'm wasting my gold. And even when I do, like, I played last weekend a bunch and got 8 wins in a couple runs. And I'm still at that point. I'm going, you lose to these decks that you're like are constructed quality and you get frustrated. And I've been working on it, but I have rage issues at times where I have to like calm myself down, and I have to like.
I know nothing of what you're talking about.
Oh, what a game have you picked for rage issues? Jeez,
well, it's one of those things, and it's funny because the more I stream, it helps with it because it helps me forces me to center myself. You know,
you don't want to act like a complete ass on the screen.
Yeah, exactly. I'm like. You guys are. This is me because I have a Twitch emote, and it's like a picture in my head, and it's called Rod Salt because I have a little like I have a little like snarl on my mouth, but and people just think it's a joke now because one of the things about me is that people my entire life have messed with me in good fashion. They're not like being mean to me most of the time, but so like people like that or give me crap about how angry about stuff, even though I'm like controlling myself when they're watching or listening or whatever. So,
oh my god, that's the tame version. It's not the full unleashed.
Yeah, it's just one of those things. I don't even try to get angry. It's just this temper that I have, and I'm like, that's why I have to like stop people from emoting at me and doing all this stuff because I just get frustrated with people. So,
well, it's also like the ADD things we have. We have no filter, basically. Yeah. So
it's
we don't have anything in us going, whoa, hey, maybe I'll not say that.
it's the whole like your mouth is connected directly to like your brain. There's no pass through. It just says things that you don't think about first. So
you don't have that mental secretary in between there going, whoa, wait, boss. You might not want what you think about this one.
Yep. It's And especially when you're upset or something, like when I get upset about something, I'm like,
my wife. You don't even want to control it then. Yeah. I'm just mad. I'm gonna let it go.
My wife will be sitting there when I get upset, and I try not to do it, but she's like, she hears me start doing stupid voices and stuff like that because I'm frustrated, and she's like, oh god, he's doing that again. I'm like, no.
Yeah, no.
I have scared the girlfriend more than once while playing Hearthstone. Yeah, are you okay? You sure you're having fun?
I'm getting a lot better, but I had my daughter also say that to me. She's like, "Are you okay, Dad? What's going on? All these bad words coming." I'm like, "No, they're not."
My wife goes, "Why do you play this game? Because exactly. I love it." You don't sound like you love it.
I think I've had that conversation.
Oh my god, it's so funny. Yeah. So, in terms of what past, present, or future, your favorite card, class, and kind of archetype or deck play style?
My favorite is, and I've said this lots, and Adam made it a running joke while we were running through our cards on for the latest set. I'm a Miracle Rogue player is my favorite. I've never had more fun than playing Miracle Rogue in this game because just it's the the crazy stuff you could do in the game with Miracle Rogue, and just it's like a puzzle to me with that deck, right? I like puzzle decks. That's why I like, I know you're not a big fan of the Razakas Priest, but Razakas Priest sometimes reminds me of that, the puzzle element of it, where you're just trying to figure out how to survive and accomplish your goal, you know? So that's my favorite. I think Rogue's still my favorite class, even though Tempo Rogue, I like Tempo Rogue, but I just think it doesn't have the skill cap that Miracle Rogue does. And my favorite class, favorite card is probably, I don't know, lately it's been Togwaggle because he's awful, but I love the card. I always love meme cards. Archbishop Benedictus is one of my favorite cards ever. I tell you guys, I have an episode of my podcast called Archbishop Benedictus GOAT, greatest of all time. So that's the kind of stuff that I enjoy doing in Hearthstone.
All right. No, that's the thing about the game, that there is something for everybody, including meme stuff that you can do if you want to. Yeah. Okay, cool. So speaking of your podcast, maybe tell us a little bit about the origin story of how you came to decide to start talking to a mic like we do.
So I had messed around with my friend Adam, who's my co-host, and talked to him about it and kind of like thrown the idea out there. But in April, when Ungoro came out, the 1600 Dust Guys, another Hearthstone podcast, had a tournament that first weekend. I ended up winning that tournament, and they had me on the podcast. And after my co-host Adam heard me on there, he's like, fine, let's do it. And so over the next month, we put it together, and I got a lot of feedback from awesome members of the community and other podcasts. And these guys helped me a lot, and I ended up doing that. And I actually created that podcast, and then I was doing a movie podcast with Tell, who used to be on Top Deck Kings for a while. I got bit by the bug real bad at first. And so we've been doing it. We just put out our 31st episode last week. So we started in June. So it's a blast, though. I love doing it. It's the creative outlet, as you guys know, that just, it helps me in a world where I sit at a desk all day playing on Microsoft Word or Excel or looking at boring code or whatever I'm doing at the particular time. It just is an outlet that I enjoy. So
yeah, I feel like I mow grass all day. This is a nice change to come and do this.
yep. It's one of those things where you get to be yourself and like put something into something, and it means a lot. I feel like people who don't need to or want to be creative don't understand when you're creative and you have that in you. It helps you unleash yourself. It helps you get something out of you that is hard to explain if you don't understand what I'm saying. So.
Oh yeah, yeah. No, oh very much. Yeah, you don't keep it bottled up. It gives you an outlet.
Yeah. So.
Yeah, there's people that have that need to just put stuff out in the world, and I think most people do. There's just different ways to do it, and this just happens to be one way to do it. So, how would you describe for people that may be interested in checking it out, your show? Like, what is it about?
So it's, we call it like a Hearthstone podcast about all about having a good time. We're casual / competitive. My co-host he's got a 1-year-old, so he doesn't always have a whole lot of time to play Hearthstone. He does a lot of it while walking or lunch breaks or something like that. But it's just two guys who like to talk about Hearthstone and have fun. These guys, Danford mentioned, I do swear quite a bit. Adam, yeah. Adam isn't the one doing that most of the time. That's me. I have fun. We like to have people on the podcast from the community, other podcasts, just good times.
Yeah, the one you had Blister Guy on, that was good.
Yeah, I love Blister Guy. That guy is
he's a good dude. Yeah. I like his podcast.
We've had him too. It's just funny.
He has excellent taste in music.
The first time I had him on my podcast, he came into my stream one night and we were doing metal things the whole time, Dan. We were he was like, play this metal band.
Start checking out your stream.
See, I go all over the place. It's not always metal on my stream, but I am a metal person. I went to a a metal festival a couple months ago involving like Black Dahlia Murder and stuff like that. So it was a good time.
Nice.
So I like metal too. So it's just, yeah, it's just a good time. And we usually kind of just talk about the state of the game, and we're not like super hardcore serious about it. And it's just, we're just trying to laugh is really what it comes down to. And I'm trying to make Adam laugh and make our listeners laugh. And we do stuff like, we had a haiku contest for a t-shirt a couple months ago. We had a, we gave out a $20 gift card for like naming your tier 5 card, which I don't know if you guys saw, there was a explosion a couple weeks ago with the positivity on Twitter where people were like giving out the 5 members of the community that are positive influences.
Yes.
I guess I need to be
we got some of those.
Oh, okay, cool.
So that was started because we gave Daniel aka Storm Rage a gift card, and he was so happy he started that. So that was all like linked back to our podcast. So it was awesome.
Nice.
That's cool.
Yeah, so it's just us having a good time and just trying to create a community and have fun and talk to people and just BS and have a good time. It's just, we're not talking about tournaments. We'll discuss decks and stuff like that depending on what's going on, but it's just two guys talking. Like, if you have any friends who you'll sit there and talk to Hearthstone about, that's kind of what we try to do.
Cool. So,
cool. Yeah. And
very good.
Where can people find it again?
It is Tier 5 Podcast. It's on iTunes. It's on Stitcher. It's on Podbean. We're on Google, the Google store.
Your favorite podcast curator of choice.
Yeah. I think the only one we're not on Spotify is we're not on is Spotify, and that's a recent thing where guys have started getting on Spotify.
Oh, we could get on Spotify. I haven't looked into that. So
yeah, I saw one of my buddies just posted about being on Spotify. So I think it's possible now. So that's something I got to look into too. But we're pretty much everywhere. We're Tier 5 Podcast on Twitter. Tier 5 Podcast at Gmail is our email address. And we're just trying to have a good time, like I say in the opening line. So
sweet. So, anything else you want to plug?
If you guys ever want to hang out with me, I have a Twitter that I have fun on. It's Rod_Johnston. And my Twitch is Rod_Johnston.
Do you have a stream schedule, or is just,
I got to set it up. So my problem is, and it makes me I have to be more flexible. My wife's in college still. And so when she starts up here pretty soon, I'm going to have a permanent schedule. I kind of just go out there and post on my Twitter feed or on my Discord. Oh, yeah. By the way, we have a Discord, discord.me/tier5, if you want to come hang out. So it's all over the place. And I'm hoping to lock down a more consistent schedule here in the next couple of weeks. So.
Well, good. Go over and subscribe. You'll find out when he's going live.
Yep, it's a good time, guys.
Yep. Very cool. We'll put some links on the notes to all your Twitters and Twitch and podcasts so that people can get to it from there. Cool. So
thanks, guys.
All right. So anything else, Dan, that we need to cover before we move on?
I can't think of anything.
All right. So what do you have for us here today that we're going to play? It's a paladin of some sort.
Yes. Listening to you guys, I know how much Dan loves Paladin, and also he loves his Aggro Paladin. He was talking about earlier this episode. So that combined with what the deck you guys played last week and the Dragon Summoner Priest, I have found a Aggro Paladin that runs Spiteful Summoner and Dino Size. So it is it's similar to a lot of the Aggro Pally lists. It's just it doesn't have as many weapons. You're running the Rallying Blade, but I think that's all, right? So it's a fun list, and it could do some broken stuff. It's got all the same problems most aggro pally lists have, where you're not running anything besides minions, so you kind of have to be creative and go wide and go hard. And the other thing is, it's not running any
spell. It, I guess.
Yeah, it doesn't run any spell breakers. So if you get to the point where you're facing Void Lords, it's a problem.
So I gotta say that he said It's like Jerry Maguire. You had me at dino size. I was like, I'm in, because I want to see this thing work. Now, the summoner thing is a good mix. I think somebody tried something like this earlier. But another thing that it does away with is the divine favor, right? So is it a problem? Like, you run out of cards here?
See, the problem I've seen with this, and I've seen this a lot in the meta right now, is that often when you need to draw cards, you're in an aggressive mirror matchup anyways. I've started to see that Divine Favor can actually be a dead card in your hand if you're facing like a Tempo Rogue or other aggro pallies. So yeah, it comes in and it can hurt, but it's that thing where you go, well, if I coin out a summoner on turn 5 and I get an awesome 8 drop, it's not going to matter anyways.
It does run the 2 call to arms, so there's a chance you get a 4 drop, which
isn't usually that bad, because you're getting a 4/4 and whatever 4 drop you're getting, as long as you don't get a really, really bad 4 drop, which is possible. It's always possible with these RNG cards in the game, right? But it is something that can happen, but you just got to go with it. You avoid keeping dino size in your opening hand because you don't want an 8 cost spell in your hand. And it usually works okay. So,
yep. Okay, so let's run through what's in here card by card, and maybe it's a Murloc version. So,
yep.
So if you could read through it and kind of tell us why or how do you use each card?
No problem. So it starts off with 2 Murloc Tidecallers, which are the 1 mana 1/2s that gain 1 attack whenever you summon a Murloc. 2 Righteous Protectors, which is the 1/1 with Taunt and Divine Shield. 2 Vilefin Inquisitors, which obviously changes your hero power to summon a 1/1 Murloc. 2 Hydrologists, which lets you discover a secret. 2 Rockpool Hunters, which give a friendly Murloc +1/+1. 2 Murloc War Leaders, obviously give your other Murlocs +2 attack. 2 Rallying Blades. 2 Call to Arms, recruit 3 minions that cost 2 or less. 2 Gentle Megasaurs. 1 Cobalt Scalebane. 1 Finja, the Flying Star, who I love, which is an interesting card because this card has kind of gone out of favor, but I like it in this matchup. 2 Spiteful Summoners, which reads Battlecry, reveal a spell from your deck, summon a random minion with the same cost. Sunkeeper Tareem, which is obviously set all other minions attack and health to 3, which gives you the ability to kind of get through taunts and whatnot and go wide and just have a killer board. It is running the Paladin Epic or Legendary Weapon, Valinir, which is cool because once it death rattles, it goes back to your hand off of a minion. So when that minion, it buffs, dies, it goes back to being equipped, right? So it's cool. 2 Bone Mares, 2 Quarter Creepers, and then 2 Dino Sizes.
Let me ask you a thing here. Rallying Blade only synergies with the Righteous. Why not the other guy, the other weapon, the new weapon, the Maul, though?
I think that my experience is that the Rallying Blade is more consistent. The problem with the Maul, and I've had this happen way too many times, you get a give all your minions taunt, and it's awful. I mean, it is awful. And I don't know why, but it seems that 3 out of 4 times I get to give my minions taunt. And when you need something else, I just think this Rallying Blade, it does only go with the Righteous Protector, like you're saying. But you could also go into Gentle Megazar and get your minions Divine Shields and go off of that. But yeah, it's just more consistent, and the 3 damage is more helpful in this metagame where you can take out things like South Sea Captains.
Okay.
It's just...
Makes sense.
You don't have to pray for RNG with it as much,
So you got, looks like 3 new cards in here, right? The Call to Arms, the Spiteful Summoner, and the Corridor Creeper. Oh, and the Valinir, so 4.
Yep.
That's not bad. So it's basically taking somewhat the existing thing and changing it a little bit. I can't believe the other day somebody played a True Silver Champion against me. I was like, whoa, that card hasn't been played in a while.
You know what I figured out, though? People seem to, if people who don't have Valinir are kind of subbing that. And it makes sense because if I didn't have the card, I would have done the same thing, I think.
True Silver was one of the best cards in the game for a long time. It's like 4-2, heals you, but there's so much broken stuff. It's like, eh, not as good anymore.
It's the whole thing where it's, you just go, you don't really need that one extra attack comparing to the Rallying Blade. And as we all figured out with the Fiery War Axe nerf, that one mana is a whole world of difference. So,
yeah. Yeah, and the healing aspect on a deck like this is not going to matter.
Yeah. But the one mana nerf to Spreading Plague is not enough.
It's I know you're an aggro player, Dan, and I know how Spreading Plague is a giant pain in the butt.
Hate that card.
It's funny because it's my first legend push ever was with Jade Druid, but the list I was running didn't even run Spreading. It ran the mind control texts and everything.
So. I don't actually come across it that much. It's just whenever you do, I give up. Okay. I can't get through all those 1/5s.
Yeah, it's a pain. As the great, I don't know if you guys know him, the great Ridiculous Hat says, it's all that butt strength. I mean, it's 5 health is just such a pain, especially for aggro decks where you're...
I still say they should be 1/3s.
Even 1/4 makes more sense, but like 5 health is
brutal.
Yeah. It's if you're not playing something like that can deal with that board, and now they have Branching Pass. So I don't know if you guys have ever had the Spreading Plague and the Branching Pass.
Oh, yeah. Of course.
Plus one attack twice.
Yep. Mm.
It's like, oh, that's a kick into a not friendly place.
A bunch of 3/7s.
Yeah,
exactly. I mean 3/5s, not 3/7s.
It's
a brutal.
At that point, 3/5s, 3/7s. What's the difference?
Who cares? Yeah.
Once you get to 5,
it doesn't matter at this point. Yeah, your little Murlocs or your little Silverhand recruits aren't going to do anything.
Unless
at that point.
Playing Paladin with Equality, that's.
So I'm assuming here in terms of Mulligan and stuff, you're looking for low drops, not the spells.
Yep.
It's pretty straightforward, shouldn't be too crazy, but
yeah, it's pretty much the same as any of the other aggro pally lists. You're just wanting to keep the ones and twos, and if you don't have any ones, I sometimes mulligan twos away because you just want to get on the board and go wide as quickly as possible.
Yep. All right, Dan, I think you should queue up. Let's get a win streak going. We've been in a good run last few weeks with the show, so I don't see why we stop now.
Hopefully I don't ruin it for you, Dan.
No pressure, Rod. It's like we've been winning. And you showed up, and it's like, oh.
I get to parties and ruin them. That's what I do, guys.
No, we've had stretches of pain and suffering, so don't worry about it.
Comes and goes.
Believe me, I understand. It's one of those things where I didn't go anywhere last season for a long time after I hit rank 5. So
I came close. I got up to rank 2, 3 stars, and then I had like a 15 game losing streak on like about the last day. I got down to rank 4. I was like, I'm not going to make that up in one day.
Yeah.
So here we go. I am going first. I have a South Sea deck hit. What the hell did I queue on the wrong deck? I did. I was flapping my lips, and I did not. All right.
Well, we can play it. We can play it.
Okay. Well, I was just going to concede. I kept this hand, which isn't awful. Okay, well.
This is
interesting. This is my aggro paladin.
This is not the right deck, but it's fine.
That's fine.
I was like, wait a minute. Yeah, I was. Well, anyway, and usually in a situation where I have a Righteous Protector, South Sea Deckhand, and the Direwolf Alpha, and a Corridor Creeper in my hand, I throw down the South Sea Deckhand first and bring out Patches, and then depending on what they do, it's not uncommon, I would go Direwolf next, or Depending on what they do and what I draw, I would go or Righteous Protector, depending.
Yeah, it's a weird thing with Priest because he has the coin, right? Because he can, if you have the South Sea, he could coin out a Potion of Madness. I kind of like the Righteous Protector turn one, but that's me. The thing with South Sea is it's the potion you have to worry about. I kind of like this Protector because then you get a 1/1 that you can put the Direwolf next to.
Just to clarify, potion costs one anyway, so you don't even need
Sorry. I don't know why I was thinking it costs two.
Alright, so, Priest played the girl, which it means Northshire Cleric. So this is one way that the Righteous gets punished versus the play that Dan suggested. So that's the thing that I was saying, that Priest gets options to punish you either way, and you can't. Yeah. There's just no way. You take a chance, and then it doesn't work. Yeah. So anyway.
So I think I'm thinking you play Direwolf Alpha and just go face because just go face because you don't want to for him to be able to kill it, right? So
no, I can't. I can't take her out.
Yep. That's one of those things about Priest is so many of these decks are singletons, right? And so you go.
Okay, so he bumped into the Righteous and got his card. Nothing we could do about that. And he draws the card and passes. So he still has the coin.
Okay, we got a Tri-Gulch Jailer.
Oh man, that could also be Potion of Madness. It's crazy. Yeah. But does he want three recruits? Maybe not.
Yeah.
He just wants to deny them from you. Anyway, go
for it. Well, do I South Sea deckhand now and get rid of the
what I would do is
of the Priestess here?
Yeah, I would South Sea on the left side of the Righteous Protector.
Yep.
And then just trade the Direwolf in the patches into the so now you're debating whether you want to play the Dry Gulch Jailer. I am
normally, I think I would just, because I only got three cards in my hand, the two Corridor Creepers and the Dragald's Jailer, I would Hero Power.
I think that's fine. It's the whole Potion of Madness that we're talking about is the one that you have to worry about at this point, right?
Yeah, and like Spirit Lash or any Pyromancer stuff, which Dan was lamenting.
Yeah.
That Priest put so many Pyromancers when he was ranked two.
Yeah, it's one of those things where it's such a powerful card, and that's what the bane of aggro decks against Priest, right, is that they can continuously destroy your board.
Yeah.
When they added in the Pyromancers.
Speak of the Devil, this is a Galanka Crawler, comes down on the South Sea, and a Holy Smite on our Direwolf Alpha, so you have a 3/4... he's at 26, 6 cards, and it's okay to dump the hand because we run Divine Favors on this deck.
Yep.
But
yep. So I draw a Rallying Blade.
So what I kind of like personally, and you could tell me what you think about this, Dan, is playing the Rallying Blade, trading the 1/1 and the 3/4 into it, and then you're going to have
a Corridor.
Yeah, one Creeper.
Yep.
I like it.
Yep, because
that's kind of what I was thinking.
The problem is, it's trading with Priest is so, it feels so bad,
it's
right?
It's super bad, yes.
But it's when you have a 3/4 on the board, he's just going to destroy your things and then heal it up.
That'll never die if you don't kill it now. Yeah. So turn 4 is the Mass Dispel. It could be Organized Circle, but that doesn't do anything. That's it. Have people been cutting Priest of the Feast? I haven't seen that card.
No, they do not cut it.
Okay. So I don't even
stupid thing.
Well, I haven't seen it in a while. It seems like they just play Mass Dispel.
You've just been lucky. I see that. Yeah.
I don't even know though at this point like what's worse for Paladin, because the Priest of the Feast, and as a Razakas player, Priest of the Feast just does so much work against aggro pally because of the butt strength, one, and two, it's the he just plays a couple spells, and the problem with Rezakis Priest against aggro pally, they're not trying to OTK you at this yeah, course, right?
They're trying to stretch it out till they get
kill
the
everything
gun.
And then yeah. they win. Yeah.
Yeah, they're trying to run you out of resources and okay.
So he play Kazakas, which most likely had the board clear, because I'm pessimistic like that.
What's you have to debate on what's I'm too optimistic often with those, right? So it's he could be doing 4 damage across the board, right?
Yep.
So I would swing in and use my face to get rid of Kazakas.
Yeah, and then you can. I'm debating.
I drew a knife juggler. I would dump my hand.
Does he still have the coin?
Yeah, he still has the coin.
So he could do Dragon Fire. Okay.
Yeah.
Anyway, go for it. You need to decide because the fuse is coming.
Yeah. So I kind of like just playing the Dry Gulch and Hero Powering because of the. If he AoEs and then you have a refill.
So that's what we do. I still got a Corridor Creeper and a Net Juggler in my hand.
Yep. It's one of these things where you go, I'm in trouble if I don't get damage in, but if he clears me and I have nothing left, you go, I'm going to have a bunch of 1/1s to throw out, and that's all.
Yeah, it's tough. Let's see. He looks like the coin to start. Nope, it's a Glimmer Root. That's good for the most part for us.
Yeah, yes. It's nothing in here is going to do all that much for him, right? And he successfully picks the card.
He did,
it's
yeah.
Not too hard to do.
It's a novice, engineer, whatever. All right.
So.
All right. What's the bonus?
Maul.
Yes.
Full attack plus 1. Nice.
Yeah.
So I think you could.
I'm tempted to play that thing.
Yeah.
Well, but hold on. Do we play anything? Or just that? A recruit, for sure, I guess.
So I'm thinking that you just. You play everything. Okay. We don't think he got AoE, right? Because he didn't play anything last turn,
well,
right?
He might. I mean, we don't know.
Thing is, if we don't get the pedal going, it's not going to matter because he's going to have what he needs. So
I kind of
usually
like
in circumstances like this, I don't even think about what he might can do. I'm like, how can I set up to do the most damage? Because whatever's going to happen is going to happen.
I like Knife Juggler and Quarter Creeper and Hero Power, and then you just play the Knife Juggler and the Quarter Creeper and go face. Or you could actually even trade one of your 1/1
weapon.
Yeah, and play the weapon. Or you could just do you could just do that. Let's go ahead. Yeah, just go face.
You could have you could have done the Dry Gulch also, and I wouldn't have traded there then.
Yeah,
that's fine. Dry Gulch was a good trade because it lets you throw another knife, a little thing there, and then prevent him from silencing it or whatever.
Yeah, it was getting to the point where the rope was going, and I'm like,
I wouldn't probably have traded most or at all there.
So
because he would be a 5.
It's Psychic Scream. He could coin out a Psychic Scream, and he looks like he's on his coin, or maybe he's not. Okay,
a Radiant. So one thing that I also thought by keeping the juggler, this is a slash, lash? Oh no, Lost in the Jungle. Yeah, it's a spirit lash, I suppose.
Yeah. Yep.
To go back to almost full health.
A whole bunch of life.
So keeping the juggler because you have Drygol. Oh no, Pyromancer. It's a circle? Oh, a Kazak. Deal 3 to all. And what else? And draw? Is that what it was?
Yeah, I think so. Let's see.
Deal 3.
It was. And
give plus 2.
Minions plus 2 health, yeah.
The draw was from the Blood Mage. But is he dead?
He's dead, yeah.
He messed up the thing. So anyway, what I was saying about hanging on to Juggler, because with the Dry Gulch, you could have the 3 guys to throw more knives.
Yeah.
Yeah. I saw the fuse going. I wanted to get as much damage in as I could, so which worked.
Hero powered
deck this time.
Yeah, that wasn't even the deck. Yeah,
wasn't even the right deck, so it doesn't even really matter. But I'm glad we played it out because, man, he obviously drew dead. And
where was Dino Size Dan? I'm so disappointed.
Yeah. It's coming. I got the right deck now.
Dan's going to be angry if there's no Dino Size. But
I think Rod was messing with me. There was no Dino Size in that deck. He's like, yeah, this is a Dino Size deck. No.
Oh, no. Not Druid.
Okay, well, most of this I'm not keeping. Balinir, a couple of bone mares, and a rock pool hunter.
So
imagine we keep the rock pool.
Yep, that's what I would do.
Okay, everything else goes back.
I love the rock pool hunter. Oh,
lovely! Again, getting the ass end of my deck here. We got gentle Megasaur, corridor creeper, which awful, and Finja.
This is a face match, because he plays an enchanted raven to start things off.
Oh. Yep, so we have... So we're off to the races, folks.
Yeah. It's they played an enchanted raven, so it's an aggro druid. I kind of feel like we have to coin out the hunter, but I'm not sure, because the problem is if he starts going completely wide on us, we're in trouble. But then we don't have a follow-up on two, so I think you kind of just have to pass...
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, because if he plays the mark, you're screwed.
Yeah. And the problem is, and when you coin out something and don't have a follow-up the next turn, it was just a waste of the coin, right? So
we can hope to draw it, but this is Hearth Coach, so that does not happen. All right, so he plays Dire Mole and a Mark of the Lotus.
Oh, well, of course.
That's a lower impact mark, though, so that's not bad.
Yeah. Then we draw Warlock... leader.
Murloc War Leader.
Murloc War
Leader. So, this is the point where you can drop the Rock Pool Hunter, but he's just going to trade the 3-3 into it. I kind of like coining out the Rallying Blade and taking that out. He's down to two cards.
Yep. I like it too.
Yeah. It's one of those things where the problem with aggro druid against other aggro decks is that they have the ability to go super wide and super tall at the same time, and it just the speed of them because of living mana gives a lot of these decks so much problem that it's hard for you to compete with them. And so the only way you end up beating them is just staying out.
And when we're playing an aggro deck and we get to turn three, we finally get a card to play. But,
this is what I was going to say, that was a bad turn. He played Dire Wolf, and then we were going to get a one-drop Murloc, and we did. So, see?
So,
we got Murloc Tide Caller, so we play that in the Rock Pool?
Yes, sir.
Oh, yeah.
And then trade with the...
kill that wolf.
Yep, trade with the Dire Wolf. So, because he's going to go in and do something, he's probably going to go face because he can't do anything unless he also hero powers and takes it out with his face.
Power of the Wild for one.
That was bad.
He's been doing some bad things. He must have living mana, but...
Yeah.
All right, so he Power of the Wild at one to take out the Tide Caller.
Yeah.
Bone
Draw Bone Mare.
So... I like playing the Megasaur here and hoping for health or a Divine Shield. So that's what I would do.
You wouldn't play Corridor Creeper now and wait for something more?
No, because the problem is at this point you're...
You need Divine Shield?
Let's see.
Divine Shield or... How much?
Plus 3 health?
I mean, that... Divine Shield and plus 3 health are exactly the same. So it's either one of those that you want. It doesn't matter.
Divine Shield.
Yep. And trade with him. Trade with him.
Yeah, you don't have healing. You're never going to get healing, so it doesn't matter.
So we got two minions on the board. We got Bone Mare, Murloc War Leader, Finja, and a 3 mana quarter creeper in the hand.
So this will be like living mana, maybe?
Yep.
Probably.
Yep.
So I would drop. You have a couple options, right? I think you just drop Finja and you double trade because then you're going to be able to play a Corridor Creeper also.
Now, we trade twice. If he gets Savage Roar, let's see. That would be...
Yep.
He can play it and then it would be 8.
Oh, you're one off.
Six.
Yeah.
That's fine.
I was thinking you had your guy was gonna die. But...
No, it yeah. wouldn't have. It's okay. Yeah. You can do it next turn.
Yeah. You're going into your power turns, and a lot of these lists aren't running.
Oh, he's trading for us anyway, yeah. and like hero powering, so whatever. That's good. Oh, he's trying to kill Finja. She's not gonna work.
Is this a bot, guys?
Yeah. He plays a dire mole on top of that. Okay, here we go.
So
we draw another Murloc War Leader. We're at 6 mana.
Yeah. So I think you trade into one of the 2/2s.
Mm-hmm. Let's see what comes out of this thing.
Yeah.
Hydrologist and a Rock Pool Hunter.
You dump everything, right? It's like Creeper, War Leader, Hero Power. I mean,
I would do both. I would drop a quarter Creeper in both War Leaders, because that's so much damage.
Okay,
and if he starts trading with the War Leaders, that doesn't hurt you either, right? Because I think none of these aggro druid lists seem to be running Bitter Tides anymore.
Yeah.
Or not all of them do anymore, so you don't even have to worry about that. But if he trades both of them into one of your War Leaders, you're gonna have an awesome turn next turn anyways. Yep. And he trades with the Finja, so that was questionable also.
The Creeper, kind of like the Creeper, another living mana. Kind of like the Creeper for the extra. Well, how much do we have here? 15.
10, 15.
And so 12?
21, 20, like 15, 21, 15, 27. 20. We have lethal with bone mirror.
Wait,
15, yeah, we 21, do. 27, and then
Bone
mirror is lethal.
Yeah, so the call was right on the. What do you call it?
The way he had been playing, I wasn't worried about him. Trading, it was very weird how he had been playing. So, I mean, he conceded, so he wasn't a bot, but that was strange nonetheless.
Okay, well, 10 full of stars.
Let's go. You're about to be. You're gonna hit a win streak if you win here again.
Yeah,
I'm glad it's Dino Size that is doing all this because that's what I was here for.
It was funny. Dan was watching me
turn 8.
No. Dan was watching me play this deck yesterday, and he was like, I want Dino Size, and I literally got set up to do it. Some guy was playing Shaman because it was the rank 10 floor, and he conceded on turn 6 when I had it in my hand. I'm like, no! Okay.
So this is a better opening hand. I get a Righteous Protector, Rallying Blade, a Rock Pool Hunter, and the Murloc War Leader.
I kind of just like keeping this whole hand.
The only thing I would have questioned is maybe the War Leader.
So you have game. You can get rid of it if you want. It's the thing with that is you have a Rock Pool Hunter, and so you're kind of hoping for other Murlocs. So if you get rid of the War Leader, that makes sense because you're only carrying the one War Leader right now. I wouldn't object to getting rid of the War Leader for now because you could possibly
that's
get
more of a
else.
Later game card.
Yeah.
All right, dump that, and we get called Arms, which. Yep. I don't object to because we do have the coin.
Still
so,
wondering why he would not kill one of the War Leaders if he was going to kill anything. Because so much damage.
Yeah, and that's what I was wondering. And I was like, well, it could prevent him. It could maybe prompt him into trading into one of them. And the only other thing that he could have done would have been to get rid of both of them would have been like a Savage Roar.
Yeah.
But
all right, Priest passes on turn one, so at least he doesn't have the girl. That's good.
Okay, so in my opening hand, I got Hydrologist is what I drew, the coin, Rock Pool, Righteous Protector, Rallying Blade, Call to Arms. Go ahead and throw down the Righteous Protector, maybe into a Rallying Blade next turn.
I kind of like coining out the Hydrologist because then turn two, you could play the Rock Pool Hunter on top of that, and you get a bigger creature to contend with.
Ooh, eye for an eye?
No, I don't know if you ever want eye for eye with with Paladin. I think Redemption is the call because you have a Righteous Protector in your hand. So a Redemption with a Righteous Protector is a
Brand new Righteous Protector.
Yep. So it's a it's one of those things, and it's frustrating as a priest to deal with Divine Shield minions, right?
Mm-hmm. So. Shadow Visions. What's he so looking that, for? Is it a combo priest? It's so early for that. There she is.
Nope, on the side. We got it in our hand. So we go ahead and play our Rock Pool Hunter.
Yep. No, play Dino Size. Oh, can't do it yet.
I wish I could. If I could play Dino Size right now, I sure would.
Dino Size?
It's going to happen. I can feel it.
And I,
you know what the best part?
To the priest. So in my hand, I got Dino Size, Redemption, Righteous Protector, Rallying Blade, Call Arms.
I think if we hit Dino Size, Frid is going to lose his mind, and we're going to have to, like, mute his mic for a couple minutes because he's going to be screaming so loudly.
I think he's got all the master controls over there.
Yeah. Radiant Elemental into Pain.
So,
okay.
I personally like the Rallying Blade and just taking out the 2/3 and going face with the Rock Pool. We're pretty confident that this is either a Razakas Priest at this point or a Combo Priest. Combo priests don't often drop out the
Radiant Elemental?
Yeah, the Radiant Elemental.
Yeah, this is Kazakus.
Yeah, yeah.
So it's the same thing we faced this few seconds
imagine
ago.
Imagine that.
Yeah.
Shocking. So
a person playing a Razakas Priest on the ladder. This is a shock.
Draw another Call to Arms. Yeah. So we go ahead and play our Call to Arms.
Yeah, I would play the one you just got, too.
Oh, really? You're from the right.
Why don't you pull from the left?
Because I think it's more tilting if he notices you just pulled it. No, it's one of those things.
He's got the Kazaka's potion that's going to kill everything. Jeez. So he'd be like, yeah, look at this pool. Anyway,
I mean, but then you do have another one, right? So
yes.
You have another, you got a refill. So I would go face tank his 3/3 and just go face with the Rock Pool. If you got an AoE, you're in trouble anyways, but that's what Call to Arms is good for, is a refill.
And you have it again.
Yeah, there
See,
you go.
See, the deal four and the summon too. So just the icing on the cake.
Yeah.
It's the best.
And he got... Yeah, that's the problem, man. It's like you...
So it's...
You off... Okay,
well...
It's fine.
Do we Call to Arms and Corridor Creeper then? Or a Righteous Protector?
Let's do the Call to Arms first and see what we get. I'm thinking you're going to want to play Corridor Creeper.
Because we drew a Righteous Protector.
Yeah,
I would throw down our Corridor Creeper for one mana. We also drew a Spiteful Summoner, which we'll probably
play.
It'll
go off
turn.
With an 8 drop unless we draw Dino Size, unluckily, which at this rate will probably happen.
Oh, don't say that.
Forest, and Raza?
Raza on 6. It's not as bad as Raza on 5. Yeah. But...
So Forest on the chat says I'm going to jump out of my chair when Dino Size hits. It may happen.
Turn 5. You never know.
He played Raza. He healed, and he healed with Binding Heal on top of that too.
Whew. So, we draw another Rallying Blade.
Don't we play the Spiteful?
We go ahead and drop the Spiteful Summoner.
Yeah, we need to do it.
We draw another Dino Size.
Yep.
Let's see it.
Yes.
Bam. Yes. Dino Size.
Tyrion, please.
Something good. Okay. That's not bad.
6/10.
Just a 6/10. Seems fine.
So what I like here is trading the 5/5 into the 3/3 and the Hydrologist into the 2/2 because you don't want that 2/2 sitting there.
No.
And then just going face with the 1/3. I mean, we're at the point where we need something good to happen anyways. With he's on a path to just destroy us, so it's...
Oh boy.
So Dragonfire. Oh.
One thing we didn't play around, he got it from Shadow Vision, so that's the thing. So now there's another one that we had to worry about.
And he probably has the Death Knight for the next turn.
Maybe. Yeah, so we can drop the Righteous Protector, play the Rallying Blade, and then. So, okay, at this point, he
Redemption?
Is. Yeah, I would play a Redemption and a Hero Power. So we have to worry about him having
swing in for 3, right?
No. Oh, no? What do you think, Fred?
It doesn't really matter. Yeah, I don't think so.
Yeah, I would just hold it too. It's one of those things where you're going, you're so in trouble at this point anyways that
the only thing is if we drew Balinir, but that's fine.
Yeah.
There's Acolyte. And there's Novice. Oh, he's drawing cards. I'm so surprised.
I feel like Frid has like nightmares about like Razaka's priest, where he's like, and he just and Razan and five.
No. Yeah, pretty much.
Okay, Dan.
We go ahead and do it.
I think.
Dino-Sai is our taunter.
Where does it go though? Hold on. This is important.
To the face.
Yeah. No, I know, but on which minion?
So actually, I think that makes sense, Dan. But I think you have to put it on the one yeah. because the two is protecting it.
Yes.
Bam. All right, then Dino-Sai's.
I would face tank
to the face.
Yeah, I would face tank the 1/3 and just go face with the other because you can't have him drawing cards as much as possible. So, and now you have to pray that he doesn't draw Anduin.
He has it.
He's already got Anduin.
Yeah, so he's going to heal, then Anduin. Oh, no. Nope. Is he traded?
Oh.
Shadowward Death. Oh, it's a silence.
Oh, no. Silence.
That's the problem with...
And that means you get a 1/1 back, too.
It's the problem with Dino Size. There's so much silence. It's okay. We got it. We got the hit. Oh, God. Power Word Shield.
Oh.
Yep.
Yeah, this was my nightmare at the end of last season.
Yeah,
this is fine. This is the shenanigans that just...
We're still in it, Dan. Don't give up.
Yeah, so I think we start off playing a... we could face tank the 3/3. So we start off doing that. So that gives us... We drew a Gentle Megasaur this turn. So I think we play the War Leader, the Gentle Megasaur, and then... We can't...
Wind Fury? Poisonous or can't be targeted?
Wind Fury,
it's that, yeah.
It doesn't matter.
And you know why? That's... And I
play the
Corridor
Creeper?
Yeah, and then just here. Yeah, just pass. Yeah.
He has the second Dragon Fire. So I'm just saying what's gonna happen before it happens.
Well,
a Spirit Lash. That's not as bad. Ugh, Smite.
This guy has.
Oh my goodness.
I don't understand because when I play this deck, it never happens like this.
Never.
You know, it's like I have.
Welcome to Hearth Coach.
Yep. This is how I play Hearthstone, is not having the cards I need on turn.
I'm not even talking about what happened, because it's one of those every answer. So Holy Smite on the War Leader after the Spirit Lash, into the Death for the Corridor Creeper, and then a 3/3 perfectly. He gets the card, challenges our Megasaur perfectly as well. So
I draw Cobalt Scale Mane, which I'll play. I guess I'll Hero Power, and I would just go to his face.
Yeah, at this point, I don't see any other path.
Yeah, it's trading isn't going to do anything at this point. At this point, you just have to hope that, and of course, it goes to the dinosaur that isn't going to
live or do anything good. Oh, this is
Anduin. Okay. He's got Anduin
off the top.
Yeah.
Yep.
Off the top. Ugh.
Do we keep going on with this?
I would hit the bottom right.
He's only
right.
got two cards in his hand.
Yeah, no cards. It's just usually how it goes. I'm telling you. It's no, more stuff. Let's not forget.
Yep. Yeah, there's no way. We can't win this game. No. Let's see what we get the next turn. Maybe we get an 8 drop that's with us. I think we can wave
we'll
the flag.
Move this on. Yep. Try again.
Yeah. Oh, those Razaka's priests, man. I've played the deck a lot, and I understand, but it's like, man, it can be so frustrating playing against that because every single turn they have the answers. So.
And then you just witnessed
what happened to me at the end of last season, why I couldn't make it to a legend. That right there, that exact thing.
You know, there's only a copy of each solitary copy of all the answers in exact order that you need every time.
Well, I got up to rank 2 last season with Aggro Paladin from rank 5, and I had to stop playing it because I was just getting out-answered every single turn, and it becomes impossible at that point. So so we have a Murloc Tidecaller, a Corridor Creeper, a Dino Size, and a Call to Arms. I like
throw back the dino size and keep the rest of it.
I think so.
I wanted that, you know, dino size to have an impact. Mm-hmm. They got silenced by a zero mana card. Eight mana gone.
We got a bone mare out of that. We draw a righteous protector.
I would just drop the righteous protector.
Okay.
Well, this is a mage. That's cool. Yeah. That's different.
I assume. Oh, so I was started seeing more control mages on the ladder yesterday, with top end heavy stuff, but like in blizzards and whatnot. But up to this point, it's been mostly secret mage, right? But and the problem with mage is they're often okay. This is control mage because he dropped a doomsayer.
That's what you're saying. And we still play a little guy to get some corridor creeper.
Yeah, so just play a hero power and then go face with your 1/1.
Get 3 discount there on the corridor.
Yep. And then we can coin out on our next turn the call to arms.
Oh yeah, more ticks on our corridor.
Yeah.
All right, it's turn 3 for mage, 29 health, arcane intellect. So this is freeze, very likely.
Yeah, it's freeze control mage.
Could be one of those with the, what's it called?
Jaina. Hunter.
Yeah, the Jaina.
We still go ahead and coin out the call arms?
Yeah, I would. Because we need, the problem is he's going to try to start AoEing us, but he also just dropped a one of his 2 doomsayers. So we kind of have to, again, it's the same thing as the priest, right? It's hard to, you're going, do I have to play around stuff?
Yeah.
I would just, you end turn. That's
we got a Vile Thin Inquisitor, a Righteous Protector, and a Hydrologist out of our called arms.
So we're in a decent spot. It's just if, oh God.
Oh, here we go.
Primordial Glyph. I have had many discussions with people in the community about this card, especially when it came out in Un'Goro. It is, I think that card is frustrating, but the reason it frustrated so many people on such a huge level was because of Ice Block, right? That card is frustrating because you can't, your knowledge of the meta doesn't matter.
That's right. That's how I lost the SHL match, by the way. It was the Primordial Glyph, getting a Flame Strike, which was the only way to get through the Void Lord and all that stuff. So, sorry. So he played Arcanologist after the Glyph. So we have no idea what that is.
What I like is playing the Vile Fin and Rallying Blade and just face tanking the 2/3.
Yeah, I like it. And we need a Mega Sword to finish this. Get plus and 3 and kill him.
Yeah, and we'll have a these decks have so much gas that it's often hard for mages to keep up with them.
Okay, there's a secret, and it was the one he drew, not... Okay, so it's to play the Medivh's Valet. Kills a Vile Fin. That's not too bad.
We draw a Rockpool Hunter, so we got 2 Rockpools.
We could go basically drop our whole hand right now. Because we're going to face tank the 2/3, right?
Yeah.
So what I like is at that point we can play the Murloc Tidecaller.
Well, not the whole hand.
Yeah. Because we can't play the bone mare. Yeah.
Well, no. Or the creeper.
What do you want to?
There's not enough mana.
Oh, okay. Yeah, we're one off.
Murloc Tidecaller.
And then I like playing, giving at least one of them to the Tidecaller.
We play the Rockpool Hunter, put one on the Tidecaller.
One to the Hydrologist?
I would put it on the Hydrologist, and then I would go face with the Vile Fin first. Because in case it is... Yeah, it's...
Ice Barrier.
Okay. Yeah. So he's gonna Blizzard now. And that's not gonna leave any room for us to do anything.
Yeah. He's still got the card from the Primordial Glyph in his hand.
That too. Could be another freeze, like Kono Cole. It could be another Frost Nova. Could be another Blizzard.
Yeah, it's one of those things. The things that frustrate me in Hearthstone are I think Blizzard came up with this term, Ben Broder, one of those guys, the fun and interactive thing. Freeze Mage is one of those things that just can drive me bonkers because it's the whole, like, you're sitting there and you can't do anything. Hearthstone isn't like Magic. You can't do things on your opponent's turn.
Oh, yeah, wow. Nothing. He fireballed one.
Well, Ice Block needs to go.
Yeah,
Ice Block needs to go to the...
So he set. It looks like he's setting up a Flame Strike, I guess. Because he fireballed the 4-3 and he pinged the shield.
Yep. I kind of like just hero powering going face with all those, but I could be like what Fred's talking about. If he has a Blizzard, it is very, very bad.
I think he would have played it. He probably has a Flame Strike, which is unusual, but could be. I don't know.
So do you think, are you on the board with just playing the hero power, Frid?
Versus just dropping it all?
I mean, yeah, because you could drop... we have the Cobalt.
Flame Strikes, it wouldn't take out the 2 5-5s. Right. Fives. Yeah. And we'd still leave us with 10 to go to his face, and then 14...
Do we do like a half and just drop the dragon? I don't know. Yeah, I can't decide.
I would drop them both because he can't hear... Because Flame Strike wouldn't take him out, and it would still be 10 points of damage.
Now, if he Frost Novas, then you pass.
Then, well...
Maybe you get a weapon. That's...
Well, this... None of the control mages play the legendary weapon, right?
Glyph.
He's searching for Nova.
So he doesn't have Blizzard.
Searching for Blizzard.
He has... is it Flame Strike? It's a secret.
It's We know what that is. That's I just said it. Ice Block. Damn it.
No, it's from the the glyph though. So
it's so Ice Block.
See, he keeps pinging these things to 4, which is like a bluff for Flame Strike. But okay, let's see here.
Take the 1-3 and hit his face first. Just
test.
Yeah.
Wait, hold on, Dan.
Yeah, hold on, Dan.
The order.
Yeah. So we want to get him down. Okay, so at this point, we're going to hit the 2 5-5s and then the 2-3.
And then the 3-3 last.
Yeah.
Now.
And then Dan, no. Okay, then you did that. We're going to have to play the bone mirror on him.
Yeah, so, that's what I figured.
Wanted to set him to 1. It's okay.
Yeah. What we were saying is that we weren't going to trade with that 2-3. We were just going to go from the 2-3.
I thought I heard say get rid of the 2-3.
No. That's fine. It's not a... we don't have it. Eye for an eye is the only one that maybe in this situation. Yeah. So.
Yeah. And we just put cards now. If he Flame Strikes us, we're going to pop his next block anyways. So.
Yeah, it's not bad. And Finja wouldn't have done anything against Flame Strike. All right, Intellect. He doesn't have anything, this guy.
This guy has been drawing like poo.
Yeah.
I guess so.
He just doesn't have it.
He's Navi. Isn't Navi the little fairy from
Zelda? Okay, there's the ice block.
There's another ice block.
And he keeps putting things to 4. I mean, it's... All right, then. Let's...
Yeah.
First, the 2-2.
Yep. The 2-2 in.
And then anything.
Yep, then doesn't matter. And...
There's block.
Two the ice one, blocks so and far.
They're both. And one was from. Oh, he's done.
Okay.
He conceded.
Sorry, was one from the glyph?
He didn't have the third ice block. That's usually what I come up against.
I've played when it was all the rage. I'd had people play 4 ice blocks.
Yeah. I was playing Face Hunter a couple seasons ago, and I got a 4. I was playing Flares in the deck, and he still had 4 Ice Blocks played on me, and I lost that game, and I'm like, no. And because it was Quest Mage, I think, at that time, and it was just like, oh.
So many Ice Blocks.
It's one of those, it's... If there were more ways to get around it, it would feel less bad, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. Well, again, we draw on the back end of the deck, but we're going to mulligan this Valinar, this Cobalt, Scalebane, and the Dino Size.
Yeah.
Because they're way too early. So come on, let's get some one drops here. Of course not. We get a Murloc War Leader, a Rallying Blade, and Spiteful Summoner.
Yeah.
And we draw a gentle Megasaur.
We wanted like last game.
This is when this deck feels bad and you're sitting there like, no. I was playing this or one of the versions of this in the last couple days. And it was, oh my god.
We dropped all the arms.
You didn't do anything, though, so.
Yeah. We hero power. That means we're playing a Jade Druid or a Big Druid. Or I actually lost to a Miracle Druid player earlier today.
So we have 10 playable cards. Just didn't draw any of them. It's like a 1 in 3. All right. There's Dino Size.
So do we...
I like the War Leader because we can gentle Megasaur next turn.
Or call to arms.
But yeah. Like, the reason why you can also maybe pull out some removal. He might coin out a. Yeah, he's going to coin out a swipe.
No, Oaken Summons.
Oh, okay.
To the Golem. So that's lucky because not like me. I always draw the Spellbreaker. That's what happens when I
play. We draw a Corridor Creeper.
So there's two options here. One of them might be riskier, is playing the gentle Megasaur. I guess there's three options. You could either play the gentle Megasaur, you could play Call to Arms, or you can play the Rallying Blade. I kind of like
Call to Arms. Setting up for a better gentle Megasaur, but
that's not bad either. Yeah, maybe just do that because the other.
There's nothing we can put on this thing that we can get.
Well,
the
Megasaur could give you poison, could give you +3. Either one of those would do it.
And that's the thing. It's how much risk you want to take at this point because this is an armor druid, which might be Jade Druid. It's probably a Jade Druid with lots of armor. So call to arms. Yeah, just drop the call to arms. We're not gonna do anything. Yeah, we're not going to do anything with that War Leader at this point.
We got a Righteous Protector.
This could be good.
Just pass.
Depends on if he has the swipe or not. Let's see.
Your magic
Spellbreaker.
Yeah.
It's not bad. It's bad, but not too bad.
What did he do there?
He killed the War Leader with the Oaken, whatever his name. What's this? Ironwood Golem? Yeah.
Yeah. So
we draw another Call to Arms.
I think we have to play the Megasaur.
Okay. Well, we play the Megasaur. See what we get. Taunt.
Poison.
Death Rattle.
Yeah.
We get the poison?
Yep. So then you rub the 1/3 into the 3/3. And then the 2/3 into the 4/3. We want to do that because he's going to trade into the 5/4 anyways.
Yep.
And then just 1/1 into the face. We want to keep him below.
Well, and we're going to get the summoner going now, so that's good. Yep.
So right. We have one Dino Slice left in the deck, right? So yes. We've drawn both Call to Arms, so yes. we know we're going to get an A-drop, which is good.
Yep. It's going to be Tyrion this time. And we're going to dinosize it. Wait, no. Hold on.
Yep. We dinosize it. Okay, we do know, by the way, at this point, that he's running Spellbreakers. So that means he probably has one more in the deck.
I don't know. It's one normally, not two. Yeah. But
okay, so we write Righteous Protector.
Summoner time.
Yep, summoner time.
Tyrion, please.
Dinosize.
Put your face in the light. And?
Marin
the sucker.
Okay. So, I kind of like trading the 5/4 and
dropping
into
the creeper?
And dropping the creeper, yeah.
Ah. Let's do it.
Yeah, because at that point we're keeping his board clear. And the thing we have to start worrying about, though, is Spreading Plague.
Mm hmm.
He's
Dan's
at eight.
Dan's favorite card. Oh, God. Oh. He gave up. What was that?
Okay.
Well. Dan, they're scared of your 666 under your name.
I guess so. Well.
Oh, God. What? Did we make it tonight?
That put me into 9. That was actually 4 games, so we got our 3 in with the deck of the evening.
Oh, that's right. We had the extra game that doesn't belong.
So that's a bonus track for everyone.
That one was able to
pull it out and charge for it or something.
That one was able to beat a priest, not this dino-sized thing. Didn't get it done.
Yeah. Right?
We did play one dino-sized, though, afraid. So you got your wish. So.
I did. So that's something.
We might have played another one if dude hadn't conceded.
Yeah, that's that's the thing. You get these weird games at the ranked floors that people just give up. And I think one of the things too is that I think a lot of people aren't great playing the druid decks because they're so slow and they get frustrated, right?
They can be
a little bit complicated. Also, this is not an unpopular deck, so who knows? Maybe the poor guy's just lost a 5 Murloc pallies in a row, and he's like, not another one.
Well, he had
tuned to beat priest.
He was ranked 9, though. He wasn't 10, so I don't know. Whatever.
That's what I'm saying. Maybe he lost a bunch of Murloc pallies, and he's just had it. He's like, no, I can't take another one.
Maybe his hand was like Wild Growth, 2 Ultimate Infestations. He's like, I'm gonna die here in like a turn or two.
Yeah, I don't know. That's the problem with that deck, right? You can dead draw real bad because so much of your hand and deck is made to make your hand bigger. And now they've pulled so many of the Jade cards out of that deck. Mm-hmm. You're not running that many Jade cards anymore. You're running Aya, you're running 2 Jade Spirits, you're running Jade Blossoms, and you're running the Jade Behemoth.
Yeah, not even the Spirits. Those things are gone.
Yeah, you've pulled it down into your... You're running like 6-7 Jade cards.
It's like Idol, Blossom, Aya, and Behemoth. That's it.
Which is what?
7.
7, yeah. So you're running those 7 Jade cards, and when you're not getting those, it can be... I mean, I've had lots of games where you're sitting there and you go, and I can win, but I don't have UI. And UI's a problem too, right? People have issues with that deck because you'll have UI and 8 cards in your hand, and you're like, so this is a dead card, so...
Yeah, that the UI hasn't bothered me. The Ultimate Infestation, I think that still needs to be tuned down some, and I really hope they retire Ice Block.
Yeah. I think I've talked about it. I think that Ice Block's going next year. They've basically confirmed it. I think they're going to get rid of Alexstrasza. I think Alexstrasza is going to get moved into the Hall of Fame. And Gadgetzan's the other one that I think might get moved out. Because Gadgetzan's also one of those things that you build whole decks around. And they don't want the same decks being, you know, prevalent over long periods of time.
I mean, it's in freaking Priest now, too.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so that was the thing with Priest, right? When I think Orange started that. The professional player Orange, he changed out the Lyra with the Auctioneer because the problem with Lyra is that you don't know what you're going to get. Mm-hmm. And I've actually kind of come to the conclusion myself, I really don't like either one of those cards in that deck because you end up wasting resources that you need to machine gun down your opponent with. Mm-hmm. And so it ends up being awkward. And I end up... Often when I play Auctioneer in that deck, I don't use more than 1 or 2 cards.
So. Just good enough. That's all you need.
Yeah, it's usually what it is. And like when you get in mirror matchups, that's all you need because you're just racing to get your combo first. So.
Yeah, I mean, it's like the old Freeze Mage without the Alex. You have... Remember how... What was it, Dan? Purple explained it to us. You had...
Oh.
Or Firebat. You have... 3 things. It's like draw, burn, and some other thing. And the burn and priest is like mind blast, Velen, you know, it's the same concept. So you draw cards, you stall, and you burn. That's it.
You know, I used to love Freeze Mage just because it punished like mid-range shaman. Because mid-range shaman was so prevalent on the ladder. And it was like one of those things where you would just... You get that. What's that? The totem dude. What's the totem dude that would like buff all your totems?
The totem dude.
There was the inspire mechanic one where you would hero power and it would buff all your totems.
Yeah, I can't remember.
I think it was like a 3/6, right? And he would here. Let me see it was like. You would just sit there and go super wide with the the shaman because they had the ability to do that. Here, let me see. Let's go to Wild World. Keep in my collection. And he would just buff all day, every day, and you would just have these amazing cards that you couldn't fight back against. What was he called?
It's a shaman card?
Yeah, the six... Thunderbluff Valiant.
Oh, the Valiant, the 3/6. Yeah.
Thunderbluff Valiant, Inspire, give your totems +2 attack.
That's right.
So that card would just make crazy control. That deck was one of the only decks ever that went from aggro to mid-range to control and could just rotate through the classes of the game, you know? So, yeah. Cool.
Well, very good. All right. We got 4 games then, or 5?
Yeah, we got 4 games in on this one.
Nice. Cool.
Thank you so much for doing this, Ren.
Thanks for having me, guys. It was a blast. You guys are a entertaining duo, and it was fun to partake.
So. Yeah, well, it was fun having you on. It was been a pretty good show. But I think for now, for the podcast proper, we'll go ahead and wrap this one up. So thank you, everybody, for hanging out and listening to our shenanigans. If you've gotten this far, you're awesome. feel free to tell your friends, your neighbors, your loved ones to please subscribe to Hearth Coach. And if you go on over to iTunes and leave us a written review, it really helps keep us up in the rankings. Maybe someday we'll actually get above some podcasts that don't even exist anymore.
There's a couple that are ahead of us, and they don't even
shows. They don't even exist, and they're above us.
It's like, how can this be? It makes no sense.
It's because people still subscribe to them, right? Mm-hmm. It's like subscription accounts. Yeah. And
I don't know how they figure their numbers.
I think subscriptions and likes and stuff like that. And they I don't know if everyone knows. You guys know. They changed it in the podcast store, and so they only show the top 8 podcasts for mm-hmm. a given search. So it's way more important now to get those likes and.
Oh, really?
I know. We try and stay up there, but if we could just get above the other 2 defunct podcasts that don't even exist anymore, we'd be up in there.
Yeah.
But that's all right. We appreciate all the, reviews and just people downloading and checking it out. We'll keep doing this and just keep on listening. If you want to support us, you can go on over to patreon.com/hearthcoach and become a patron and get in on our tournaments. Everybody that $5 and up a month gets you in on the possibility of getting in on our quarterly tournaments. And the more people that subscribe to our Patreon, the more prize pool we will give out at the tournaments. So that's how that works. You can go on over to HearthCoachPodcast.net and check
HearthCoach.net.
Oh, wow.
HearthCoachPodcast@gmail.com.
I knew that was wrong when it came out. That
is the email.
Keep it straight, friend.
It's all good. So HearthCoach.net for our website, where you could see Rod's entry to the Hall of Legends, as well as the deck list and the shows. You could write to us at hearthcoachpodcast@gmail.com with your Hall of Legends entries or any other general questions or comments. As we've been mentioning, keep those reviews coming on iTunes. They're the most important and help us go up in the rankings. I think we had one, Dan, but because we had a guest, we skipped it. So we'll talk about it next week. But we had one come in. Let's see.
And you can go over to the website and see the picture of me with my boy Jamie Josta and George Corpse Grinder Fisher.
Then you have the battle tag exchange.
Yes, if you need some friends for your battle tag, Yeah, you all know what I mean.
To play with. There's plenty of names there to pick from the community. Let's see. Is there anything else? Patreon.com.
I'm not going to say anything else.
/HearthCoach. We're on Facebook. We're on Twitter. And then I'll give Rod the last plug here so he can remind everybody where to find his stuff.
Simple way.
Okay, guys. I am on Twitter at Rod_Johnston. And my Twitch is twitch.tv/Rod_Johnston. My podcast is Tier 5 Podcast. It's just a good time blast of a Hearthstone podcast. So come listen, download, and hang out. As long as you don't hate language. If you don't like language, don't download it, because I don't want to hurt your feelings and get angry emails. So, and we have a Discord at discord.me/tier5. So come hang out there. It's a good time. And just or our Twitter, tier5 podcast. And that's with the number 5 podcast at Twitter. So you can come email or message me on Twitter or message us on Twitter. And I will respond there and hang out and whatever. It's a good time, guys. And I had a blast coming and
thanks for doing it.
No problem, guys.
Please go follow his stuff. I'll put links on the notes so that you can get to it. But we appreciate Rod coming on. Good luck with the podcast. Good luck with the stream and all that good stuff. So with that, we'll call it a wrap.
Good luck getting the legend, everyone.
Good luck, everyone.
Good luck, everyone.
All right, so the recording is done, but the stream is still going. I don't know if there's anyone out there. Let me take a look. There was quite a few people in the chat.
Nice.
I heard Forrest. I love Forrest. Is that Forrest Bates? I love that guy. Someone told me that Forrest looks like my father, and I realized that Forrest and I both have massive heads. Like, we both wear a size 8 hat. This hat is just massive. It is really, really large. So it's one of those things where, but I love my baseball hat. So, but yeah. Forrest is good people. So,
oh yeah, he's awesome. Okay, so let's see if there's anything out here. Thunder Rough Valiant. Somebody bailed us out on the chat since we couldn't come up with the name.
I had to go look because I was like, I think I tried to wipe that card from my memory.
That's so bad.
That card caused me so much frustration.
Bring up bad memories.
Yeah. It's like they're like back to like war flashbacks, you know?
Yeah. So we had the Clap, we had Apex Predator, Stray Dogs, Orochio, Forest, Andrew is Living, The Daily Gear. We had Chris Lechness, who goes by Torlan.
Andrew, hit me up.
Andrew's Living, Dr. Ogreface, and Apex Predator again. So
cool.
That's pretty
Andrew
cool.
Andrew is Living, that's the Happy Hearthstone.
Yeah, there he is.
I love Andrew. He's good people, man. It's funny. I'm tall, and I met him at DreamHack Denver because we hung out that whole weekend. And that dude is like an inch or so taller than me. I'm like, this dude is giant. It's funny. When you don't know, you meet people online, you just have this formed image of them and like how big they are. And it's like ridiculous hat is like 5'3". And so it's one of those things where it's like, because I sent them a t-shirt. We have our tier 5 t-shirts that Ben at Dad Legend. I should have said that. Not that anyone cares. But like, we're selling on Dad Legend. We're selling our tier 5 t-shirts. But I was like, I'm going to send Ridiculous Hat a t-shirt for helping out set up my podcast. And he's like, I want a small. I'm like, how tiny are you, Ridiculous Hat? Yeah, he wears a small. He's a little dude.
I want to hit him up about set, because he has a soundboard set up and I can't figure out how to set up so I can play drops but I can actually hear them while I play them.
Yeah,
I got it, you know, I could got it worked out so that, you know, Fred would hear them and they would come through, but so I couldn't hear them when I played them. So
good old Mr. Jones shows up and he's like, I got here, did I miss the show? I'm like, dude, you're late.
That's funny, man.
Yeah, kinda.
I need to buy one of the soundboards for myself too. Like, it's one of those things where I'm like, it's when you get started with this podcast thing, you go, I want to spend money, but I don't want to overdo it in case like it doesn't, you know, you maybe you struggle or maybe you don't enjoy doing it. But it's funny, like I started off with just a microphone and a pop filter screen. Mm-hmm. And then I bought a mic arm that cost twice as much as my microphone. Mm-hmm. Like my arm was $120 while my mic was like $60 for the mic and the thing. And I'm just like,
yeah, I'm completely opposite. My mic thing here is about $15 and my microphone's $100.
Yeah.
Yeah. I had
I'll never need another microphone.
I had one of those, Rode, whatever the crap arm that was like $100. So
yeah, this is a Hale or Heil one, and it was suggested by the Ridiculous Hat. He was like, this is the best one out there. or for that money. I think you could go more than this.
$15 eBay special.
That's what he said. Ridiculous Hats, like, there are two options. You either spend like $15 or you spend $120. Yep. Like, that's like, there's no in betweens. There's like cheaper ones and then there's expensive ones. Yep. So,
yep, pretty much.
Yep.
Okay. And hell, guys,
this thing survived the flood.
I think I don't see any activity here in the chat, okay, so we could close down the stream.
Well, thanks for having me again, guys.
No, thank you.
We'll talk to you again sometime. I'll subscribe to your channel and try and catch you streaming.
Well, guys, thanks a lot, and I will talk to you soon.
Goodbye, everyone.
Bye.